going to let the little kids go to Sunday morning church for them. So they can go now. As James was telling me, because I forgot I was going to go right into the message. But they're going to get a message for them specifically. And that's the thing about church. When I look at these mega churches, and there's like thousands of people in this church, and this pastor is preaching a sermon, but how can that same topic be applicable to everyone? I don't know if it is. I think you can always get something out of a service, especially in the worship part, you know? But I think, Lord, how can this one message, you know, pertain to everybody? And sometimes it really doesn't. But the fact that you're just in the house of the Lord with other believers, coming before Him, and just experiencing His presence. You know, not everybody can relate to divorce. Not everybody can relate to marriage. There's single people in the crowd, you know. Not everybody can relate to sickness or disease or, you know, but there are people who have that. And so the Word of God, I love it because it's just all-encompassing. And some Sundays we speak on particular subjects. Last Sunday we spoke on the Holy Spirit. And this Sunday we're going to keep going on the Holy Spirit. So let's take a moment to pray before we get into the Word. Lord, I'm so thankful for every person that's here this morning, Lord. I'm so thankful that you're here this morning. Lord, for people who aren't here, Lord, I just pray that you'd minister to them and bless them, and that you'd draw them, Lord. You'd draw them to a church, our church, but just to be in fellowship with other believers. Lord, we need each other. You said we are one body, many parts, so we need all the parts of the body. And so, Lord, for those who aren't here, bless them, minister to them. Lord, give us ears that we might hear this morning, Lord, that your word might go forth. It's all about you, King Jesus. Amen. So I'm going to quickly run through the slides from last week and then get into what we've got prepared for this week. So last week we talked about the different appearances of the Spirit of God in the Old Testament, and then we're going to get into the New Testament. So in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. There were empty, darkness was over the surface of the deep, and the Spirit of God was hovering over the waters. That Spirit of God, that creative Spirit. And we're going to see that creativeness of the Spirit is the same in the Old Testament and the New Testament. Let's keep going. We talked about the Spirit of God being in Joseph, and it was a spirit of wisdom. Joseph could interpret dreams. Let's keep going. It says, do not turn to mediums or speak out spiritists, or people who would try to encounter other spirits or call up other spirits. And then the Lord came down in the cloud and spoke with, and the power of the Spirit was on him. So we talked about Moses and how the power of the Spirit was actually on Moses. Talked about Joshua was filled with the Spirit of wisdom. The Spirit of the Lord came upon Gideon. The Spirit of the Lord came powerfully upon Samson. The Spirit of the Lord again came up upon him to give him strength. The Spirit of the Lord, the Holy Spirit, comes to equip us to do something. Gives us the spirit of prophecy. We see Saul prophesying. We see the Spirit of the Lord coming upon David. We see the Spirit of the Lord on Elisha, giving him insight into something that happened that he wasn't even there to witness, but the Spirit of the Lord revealed it to him. The Spirit of the Lord came upon Zechariah, and the Spirit of the Lord warns us of danger. Right? You ever have that in your life where you're going, I'm not sure I should or not? The Spirit of the Lord is there to warn us. And then he'd pour out his Spirit on our offspring, on our descendants. And then Jesus read from the book of Isaiah, the Spirit of the Sovereign Lord is on me because the Lord has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor, to bind up the brokenhearted, freedom for the captives, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor, to comfort those who mourn, give a crown of beauty instead of ashes, the oil of joy instead of mourning, and a garment of praise instead of a spirit of despair. Let's keep going. Daniel was interpreting dreams through the Spirit of the Lord. The Spirit of the Lord tells us what's right and wrong. I will put my Spirit in you and you will live. I will pour out my Spirit on all people, on your sons and your daughters, and they will prophesy. They will see dreams and visions. Keep going. And then we transition into the New Testament, where we read John, well, we read in John where Jesus is saying that he will send the Comforter. And it's important that he leaves so that the Comforter will come. Okay, next slide. And now we're going to continue forward. James. New Testament, the birth of Jesus Christ and the Holy Spirit. Do not be afraid. So an angel comes and visits Mary. Do not be afraid, Mary, for you have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and called the Son of the Most High. The Lord will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end. Mary says, how will this be? I'm a virgin. The angel answered, the Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So here again, we see the creative power of the Holy Spirit that we saw in Genesis, now on Mary, creating baby Jesus. So the Holy One will be born, will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age, and she who was said to be unable to conceive is in her sixth month. For no word from God will ever fail. Now what happens oftentimes, we get a word from God, and we embrace it, and we say, wow, is that ever good? You know, we read about his promise in the Word, or God ministers to our heart. And then as soon as he does that, what happens? Opposition comes. And we start to doubt his word. We start to look at the physical circumstances in our life rather than what he told us. So here, again, for no word from God will ever fail. Next slide. John the Baptist comes. And so here we read, for he will be great in the sight of the Lord. He is never to take wine or other fermented drink, and he will be filled with the Holy Spirit even before he is born. How is that possible? In Luke we read, and he will go on before the Lord, still talking about John the Baptist, in the spirit and in the power of Elijah, to turn the hearts of the parents to their children and the disobedient to the wisdom of the righteous, to make ready a people prepared for the Lord. In Luke we read, when Elizabeth heard Mary's greeting, okay, so now Mary is going to visit her cousin Elizabeth, and what happens? The baby leaped in her womb, and Elizabeth was filled with the Holy Spirit. You ever have that? Somebody's talking, or you meet somebody, and there's kind of something's going on in your conversation, you're connecting with someone. Especially when it's a Christian, because the Spirit of the Lord is there, and now there's a connection happening, and this is what happens. The baby leaped in her womb because John the Baptist was filled with the Holy Spirit even before he was born. So when Mary comes pregnant with Jesus, the Savior of the world, the infant, John the Baptist, reacts to it. John the Baptist's father, Zechariah, was filled with the Holy Spirit and prophesy. And the child grew and became strong in spirit. What does that mean? The child grew and became strong in spirit. John the Baptist grew and became strong in spirit. He matured. He developed his spiritual gifts. he lived in the wilderness until he appeared publicly to Israel. So we see later, we know how Jesus went into the wilderness for 40 days. We read here John the Baptist was in the wilderness too. Because when you're cut off from everything else, and this is why so many people encounter Jesus when they're in prison, because everything else has been removed in their life. When everything else is stripped away, you tend to look to God. And when that happens, he starts to become your only source. But what happens to us sometimes, we start to fill ourselves with other sources. Not as good. Hey, Max?
Yeah.
Not as good as the real thing. Not as good. Hallelujah.
Zach, Max has got such an awesome testimony.
Let's go back. Sorry, James. And he grew, became strong in spirit in the wilderness until he appeared publicly to Israel. So there was a time. Everything is process. Everything that's happening in your life is preparation for the next thing. So John the Baptist didn't come out publicly in Israel until it was time. Jesus didn't come out publicly in his ministry until it was time. Now there was a man in Jerusalem called Simeon who was righteous and devout. He was waiting for the consolation of Israel. So he's waiting for the Roman Empire to be dispersed and for Israel to come together again as a nation. And the Holy Spirit was on him. So we see that the Spirit is in somebody, like it was John the Baptist, but we also see that it comes on somebody. And we read that before in the Old Testament too. And the Holy Spirit was on him. It had been revealed to him by the Holy Spirit that he would not die before he had seen the Lord's Messiah. All these years, he's an old man now, but there was something in him that the Lord had revealed to him, I'm not going to let you die before you see the Messiah. Because he was chasing after something. He was passionate about this thing, about the nation of Israel seeing the Messiah. And so the Lord said to him, you're not going to go until you see the Messiah. So he had this thing in his heart. But year after year goes on, all these babies come through the temple, they get circumcised, they get dedicated to the Lord, right? But something today was happening in him that was a little bit different. Let's go to the next one. Moved by the Spirit. Moved by the Spirit. What does that mean? It means the Spirit was ministering to him and he knew he had to go to the temple that day. He went to the temple courts when the parents brought the child Jesus to do for him what the custom of the... So he's going to be circumcised. Simeon took him in his arms and praised God, saying, Sovereign Lord, as you promised, God's promises are yes and amen. Whatever God has told you he will do, he will do. You may now dismiss your servant in peace, for my eyes have seen your salvation, which you have prepared in the sight of all nations, a light for revelation to the Gentiles and the glory of your people Israel. Wow. Wow. Coincidence that Simeon was in the temple that day? No. No. God is a great orchestrator. If there's anything we've experienced, Renee and I, in our life, that he orchestrates events that seem sometimes inconsequential, but all of a sudden they start to come together. And wow, that's God. And so here we see with Simeon, the baby Jesus, the promise, he's moved by the Spirit. There it is. Oh, now I can go. Going on in Luke, we were reading about John the Baptist, and they were talking to John, and John answered them all, and he said, I baptize you with water, but one who is more powerful than I. So what power did John the Baptist have? Well, we just read a little while ago that the power of Elijah, right? We read that? John the Baptist, he'd walk in the power of Elijah. and he would turn the hearts. And so that's what he's doing. He's calling out to the people of Israel for repentance. He's preparing the way, a repentance, a forgiveness, a confessing of sins. He's preparing the way. I baptize you with water, but one who is more powerful than I will come, the straps of whose sandals I am not worthy to untie. He will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and
fire.
Okay, I was going to say this is an easy one. And fire. What does that mean?
Isn't fire God?
Yeah. Yeah. But there's a fire, a burning that happens when the Holy Spirit comes. And it's hard for me to describe, but it feels like, oh, intense love, I'm not worthy, power, all this stuff, all in one. When I get close to God, I often weep. I just cry. I can't help it. His love is just so heavy. I just melt like butter. You know. But there's a component that happens that is like fire. In the Old Testament, we saw fire in the burning bush. Moses saw fire on the burning bush, but it wasn't consumed. In the New Testament, we see fire on the heads of the disciples who were just baptized with the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit and fire. When we read on, when Jesus is baptized, the Holy Spirit descended on him in bodily form like a dove. So here we see the manifest presence of the Holy Spirit coming down like a dove. You know, Benny Hinn Ministries, he's got that dove thing. You know, a lot of ministries show this picture of this dove. Because the Holy Spirit is so important in our lives. And of course, God speaks, "You are my Son, whom I love. With you, I am well pleased." Then we read, Jesus, full of the Holy Spirit, left Jordan and was led by the Spirit into the wilderness. Also like John the Baptist, who spent all that time in the wilderness. Sometimes there's an experience with God where everything else is stripped away that we think is important, and we just have to get real, and you have to be comfortable in your own skin, I kind of call it. And then you put all your attention on him. And he transforms you. I think on the Dunamis Facebook page, I put, the more I think about Jesus, the more I like other people.
And that sounds like an old Mark Twain quote.
Is it?
The more I know about people, the more I like my own dog.
Oh.
Well,
that's a good point, Max, because people can often agitate us and get us upset, right? We'll get bent out of shape because of other people. But I find that the more I think about Jesus, the more I start to like other people. The more I start to like myself.
And so Jesus goes to the temple. And so what I'm trying to do is pick and choose all these places where the word Spirit and Holy Spirit is used. And so the Spirit of the Lord is on me because he has anointed me to proclaim good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners, recovery of sight for the blind, to set the oppressed free. So it's prophesied about in Isaiah. Jesus comes into the temple, picks up the scroll, and reads it. And the Spirit of the Lord comes for freedom. Freedom from oppression. We continue on in Luke 4. In the synagogue, there was a man possessed by a demon, an impure spirit. And he cried out at the top of his voice in the synagogue, in the house of God. So it's not impossible to be in church and have people who are being tormented by evil spirits, even in the house of God. Because Satan is a tormentor. That's his final destination, is torment. But in the meantime, he wants to torment us. So here we are in the synagogue, and this demon speaks up. Jesus says, "Be quiet. Come out of him." The demon threw the man down before them all and came out without injuring him. All the people were amazed and said to each other, "What words these are." What words? What words?
Come out of him.
Come out of him and the previous thing. Both combined. Because they just listened to Jesus read from Isaiah about freedom for the captives and the prisoners and those who are oppressed. So there's the word of God. Now the Holy Spirit empowers Jesus' words to come out of him. Both are in effect here. What he just read out of the word, that's why it's so important to speak the word of God over our situations. Because when you do that, the Holy Spirit is there empowering the words of God over your situation. So he just reads the authority that is given to him, and then he speaks it out, and the demon leaves. And people go, "Wow, what words!" With authority and power, he gives orders to impure spirits, and they come out. Authority and power in the name of Jesus. Let's keep going. And again we read, as Jesus goes about preaching, because now he's getting pretty popular, he's starting to attract a crowd. And they come to him to be healed of their diseases. And those troubled with impure spirits were cured. Now, here it doesn't say that the impure spirits were cast out. Did you notice that? It says those who were troubled by impure spirits were cured. Because sometimes we allow torment to come into our life. We think about a situation over and over and over, and the situation starts speaking to us, and we're consumed by it. And then when somebody comes up and there's a problem, they cut you off in traffic, what happens? You explode and get mad.
That happened to me the other day. I don't drive, but I was taking my dog for a walk, and the little dude told me to walk around. And I'm not lying, some guy drove right around the corner, and I guess I shouldn't have done it, but I like walked right up to his door and I just let loose on him. He almost ran.
I know.
He can run me over, but he ain't gonna run my dog over.
We think you're more important, Max.
It really ticked me off.
So that happens, right?
Yeah.
But what often happens is there's something that's building up inside of us, a tormenting spirit. You know, it could be worry, it could be fear, it could be our self-image, you know, of who we are, do people love me, all these different things. And they start to torment us. But when Jesus preaches about good news, about how much the Father loves you, that starts to change things. Impure spirits don't like to hang around in the presence of the Most High God. When you start to read the Word of God, when you start to think about Jesus, just like I said, the more I think about Jesus, the more I start to develop a love for other people. When that starts to happen, your heart starts to change. That's why we said church is always going to be about Jesus. We're going to talk about Jesus a lot. At that very time, Jesus cured many who had diseases, sicknesses, and evil spirits, and gave sight to many who were blind. Now, sometimes we blame stuff on evil spirits that aren't to be blamed on evil spirits necessarily. Sometimes it's just stupidity, or sometimes it's selfishness, you know? There are different reasons. So it's not always evil or unclean spirits, but sometimes if there's a habitual thing that's happening, you know, or you're... I can tell in Max when God made a big change in his life, because his countenance, his facial expressions, the clarity in his eyes was different.
I haven't smoked marijuana in 2 months.
Come on!
Yeah. I know that's no big deal. Really.
It's a huge deal, Max. It's a huge deal. And also some women who had been cured of evil spirits and diseases, Mary Magdalene, whom had 7 demons, had come out of her. So the reason I'm talking about spirits and the Holy Spirit is so that we can start to develop some wisdom and insight, because as the church grows, we're going to encounter some of this stuff. Number one, we're going to encounter the Holy Spirit. But people are attracted to Jesus and to the gospel message. And when they come, they're going to come with their garbage. And Jesus is going to set them free. Another example, even while the boy was coming, the demon threw him to the ground in a convulsion. But Jesus rebuked the impure spirit, healed the boy, and gave him back to his father. Jesus rebuked the impure spirit. And that's when we pray, I often pray, Jesus, you do it. I don't have to do it. Jesus, you do it. And then Jesus, people go, wow, Jesus, power over the spirit realm. We could never cast that spirit out, but you did. Jesus says, I know. But then what he says, do not rejoice that the spirit submit to you. That the spirits submit to you, the spirits submit to you and the word of God and the kingship and authority that Jesus Christ has in your life. That's who they submit to. Don't rejoice that the spirits submit to you, but rejoice that your names are written in heaven. Woo! We all have different gifts, and I haven't addressed the gifts of the Spirit yet. But we all have different gifts. You're all valuable. You're all valuable to Jesus, to the kingdom of God. We're all on the same team. You know, on football teams, sometimes there's these big linemen, and other times there's these really fast receivers who've got good hands to catch the ball. Quarterback who really sees things quickly and can throw the ball. Everyone has a different gift, but the team couldn't win. They couldn't compete unless they had all those different elements. So the quarterback can't say, well, I'm way better than the receiver, right? Because then the lineman will say, man, if you didn't have me, you'd be killed back there, you know? We're all part of it. We've all got gifts. At that time, Jesus, full of
joy.
Joy. This is some of the things that I struggle with. Joy. I don't always feel joyful. You ever notice people that just seem happy all the time? What is with that? I wish I had some of that. I don't feel happy all the time. But when I think about Jesus and his goodness, that starts to change my mood a little bit. When I start to read my word or put on a worship thing, listen, worship CDs are good, but worshiping him with your own mouth? Way good. Full of joy through the Holy Spirit. So he's full of joy. And he just says, I praise you, Father, Lord of heaven and earth, because you have hidden these things from the wise and the learned and revealed them to little children. Yes, Father, for this is what you were pleased to do. You revealed them to little children. You don't have to be an intellectual brainiac to get the gospel. In fact, your brain will sometimes not compute what the gospel message is saying. But when you receive Jesus, when you accept his word as a little child, you know, you can see Carly Bruno walking along with a little kid. He's about to cross the street, and Carly says, "No, don't, there's cars coming." The little kid will freeze and say, "Okay, I won't." Because they just accept that word as truth. And so we too accept God's word as truth. We need to understand it, but if your brain will try to fight it, your brain will try to say, "Man, why would you ever give an offering to church when you've got this bill over here to pay? Why would you ever help so-and-so? They've never helped you." Hey, see how that thing works? It doesn't necessarily make sense in the natural, but to God it makes all the sense in the world. You see, God's a giver. He just gives. He gave his son. He gave his spirit. He gave us his word. He's just a giver. And he gives because when you become a parent, things change. You want the best for your child. You want to protect them, so you instruct them. You know, you discipline them. You say, "Don't!" You know, in that angry voice, because they were just about to hurt themselves. Now, the child doesn't always get why God is saying don't, but God wants what's best for you. And as you start to grow up, you go, "Okay, I get it. That's why you said don't. Okay, I get it." And so even when we've made mistakes and screwed up our life so badly, Jesus is the Redeemer. He makes all things new.
Amen.
Doesn't matter what you've done. Doesn't matter how stupid you've been, how sexually immoral you've been, how much dope you've smoked. Doesn't matter, doesn't matter, doesn't matter. Because when you join his team, he becomes the coach. He starts to tell you what to do, and you start to listen, and you start to win.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Joy through the Holy Spirit. So then, Jesus talks about the gift of the Holy Spirit and asking for the Holy Spirit. In Luke we read, "If you then, though you are evil, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will your Father in heaven give the Holy Spirit to those who ask?" What do you have to do to get the Holy Spirit? You need to ask. Just like wisdom. How do I get wisdom? Ask and listen. Ask and listen. When I was at the lowest part of my life, so I was raised in a Christian home and stuff, but I had really gotten full of sin and just awful stuff happened in my life. And, you know, Renee and I were on the outs, lost my job, house was for sale. I remember that little phrase in John that said, "If I will ask for the Comforter, he will send him." And so I remember crying beside my bed, saying, "Lord, I need the Comforter." I had no idea what I was asking for. Honest, I had just something I heard in Sunday school somewhere, something I read, something I heard, I don't know. But something, you see, man, when you are desperate for God, he always answers. He always comes. He always answers. He always comes. And so when I did that, he changed me. 3 days later in a small Bible group, you know, bam, kaboom, my life has changed forever. So this is talking John the Baptist here. "I myself did not know him, but the one who sent me to baptize with water told me, 'The man on whom you see the Spirit come down and remain is the one who will baptize with the Holy Spirit.'" So there's an asking for the Holy Spirit. There's an indwelling of the Holy Spirit. The Holy Spirit can come upon you. And then there's a baptism of the Holy Spirit. And so when I was in that small group I told you about, God baptized me in the Holy Spirit. And now when we think of baptism in the Holy Spirit, we start to think about all those gifts, and I don't want to go into those right now. But there's a baptism that happens in the Holy Spirit, because we read about it here. And Jesus answered, "Very truly I tell you, no one can enter the kingdom of God unless they are born of water and spirit." So there's a spirit. Our spirit man changes. We now take on the Holy Spirit. The Spirit of God. You know, he says, "Now I write my laws on your hearts." So there's a transformation that comes when we receive the Holy Spirit. Philippians flesh gives birth to flesh, but the spirit gives birth to spirit. So now we have this spirit in us, and things are changing, and we will start to grow in the spirit, and the spirit will start to give birth to spiritual gifts. It'll start to give birth to things in your life. It'll start to change you. You'll start to have a compassion for others. You want to help others. You want to use your money for the kingdom. It starts to give birth to things. It starts to give birth to a ministry in your life. And ministry doesn't mean a microphone and a pulpit and a bunch of people listening. Ministry means helping people in the name of Jesus. Ministry means setting up before church. Ministry means a whole bunch of different things. But when you ask for the Holy Spirit and He comes, it'll birth something in your life. Newness. Part three next week. Part three next week. So I can't tell you, I'm not sure if all this is computing, if you missed last Sunday or if you're getting this. To me, the Holy Spirit isn't a black and white thing. Here we read about sending the Comforter. So is the Holy Spirit a person? Is it a spirit? Is it a power? I think it's all three of both, because there is power that comes through the Holy Spirit that we can't see. That enabling power, the thing that we saw with Samson, that power that created when God spoke and created the earth, that power that came and created within Mary, baby Jesus. It's like all three. So don't try to say the Holy Spirit is this, because then there's the anointing of the Holy Spirit and it gets all confusing and stuff. But let God minister to you. The best way for the Holy Spirit is to read God's word and let this spend time with God, and the Spirit will come upon you and He'll spend time with you. Let's pray. Lord, we just want to hear from you, God. Mm-hmm. We just want to hear from you. We want to know more about you. We want to be able to live in this freedom that you bring us, that you give us, freedom from oppression, Lord. Freedom from disease and sickness and all these things. And so, Lord, we want your Spirit to minister to us, Lord Jesus. Holy Spirit, come and minister to us. Come and minister to us. Lord, we need you. Every day we need you. Thank you, Holy Spirit, that you speak to us. Lord, teach us about you, Holy Spirit. Manifest your presence in our midst, Lord. May we be followers of Jesus Christ. Soften our hearts to love others.